All right, so for this week, I'm going to ask you to complete the course evaluation. So if you go into the root of Moodle, or if you're in a course, just click on the home button. It'll be somewhere around here. You can see all your courses, and over here on the right, there's these tasks. You should see at least one class, but if you see the information design techniques class, you can click there and just fill out the course evaluation form. If you're still stuck on sprints 1 or 2, or you're slow in sprint 3, please come to office hours. As we move through sprint 3, sprint 4 is really like, I got bugs, it's called refactoring. I'm going to clean up my code. I got a lot of naming issues. My comments are a mess. I really have this like whole monolithic code, this like one big script. I should really break up into a few classes, make it easier to absorb. The whole point of like a refactoring is that somebody else, or more importantly, you, can come back and kind of understand where your project was at, where your code was at. Because as you might have noticed, as you jump from week to week between all your classes, you probably forget. Like, I'll jump back into this project after other classes, and I'll forget what I'm doing, and I have to read through the code and quickly get back up to speed. So I want to clean up the code. I want to get rid of bugs. I have some features that I got to clean up. Like, some of the UI is broken on some of the prefabs. I want to convert some of the animation over to code. These are the things I'm doing for Sprint 4. So as we kind of coast and kind of wrap up the semester, like, just stay strong every week. And if you're behind, just come to lab time so we can get you back up to speed. Here at the beginning of Sprint 3, I have the sprint deliverables. So if I click there, it's the title, three. You want to create 3 prefabs, each having 3 animations, and we need to update the user interface. And all that also has a corresponding coding update to it as well. So if I click play, I've kind of cleaned up the user interface a little bit. This area kind of pertains to animation. This is kind of destroying objects, generating objects, and this is like the size, the color and stuff. But if I turn off time destroy, and I got my one paint stroke, my one prefab, and I press 1, 2, and 3. It has 3 animations. And if I switch to another prefab, and let me just increase the size a little bit, we have 1, 2, and 3. And then if I jump to my last prefab, we have 1, 2, and 3. And so I have 3 paint strokes each with 3 different animations. And I'm able to switch which objects. You know, we have this whole destroy feature. I can speed up, I can slow down, I even pause the animation. I can switch animation type is currently playing. And we have a randomization on the animations, all of which I'll cover in class. And if you notice that, like, for example, the color, it looks like it's working on all 3. And just, we have to like double check. We have to test. Do all the colors work? Does the size work? And that's only for 2. This one I need to update. Looks like the glow works. No, it doesn't. Completely overrides it. This must have been working last class. Let me take a look at that. But anyway, I was just testing my user interface. I just found an issue with the emission. I got to go and check. But the point is that you got to go through. It's all functional. And you're going to get it up onto itch.io. And get it into your posting. So that's where we need to get you at the end of the week. So I'm going to go over a review what I did last week. I'm going to show you how to make a bunch more prefabs or animations, review that phase. And there's a good part of the code that I still need to cover. And then you know everything you need to do to build your own Sprint 3. So this is the deliverable doc. So it's just like, I'm going to create this. This is each feature should be mapped out in user flow. You can write out your project description, yada yada. Here's the user flow. All right, flows. And a lot of and that information is mirrored down now into Sprint 3, the actual forum that you're going to post this Sunday at 4:14, April 14th at midnight. And here's my example posting. And you're going to put in your project description. Here's the flows that you're going to generate yourself. And a link to your itch.io build, which is this, and then to embed it. So has anyone actually tried to embed it in Sprint 2? You did, and you were having the issues, right? Oh, well, at least for me, I could demonstrate quickly what it looks like. You guys will just stick to posting up the link. It'd be cool for you to embed your your demos, but whatever. You can embed this in your portfolio sites. So moving forward, just so you're aware, that embed code, actually, you can embed it on your website. So I've embedded it on mine. So when you think about when you're graduating, you want to clean up your projects. That's the one thing I like about this, is that now I got my code right here in GitHub. And I can show off the actual workable demo. Two big things that you're going to need to think about. Whether it's websites or mobile apps, whatever. So anyway, this, fine, if I ignore the embeddedness, your project description, your user flows, and your link to your build, right? Sprint 3 this Sunday. So let's go through the rest of the information you need to do that. And then we're going to move on to Sprint 4, which is more about refactoring, code cleanup, getting rid of bugs. There's a few slight features that I'm going to implement. So I have it up on the board here. And I'm going to have to copy and paste this onto Moodle. But it's I'd like to update the dropdown with the animation names. So right now the dropdown, I just have like scale, position, rotation. But I'd like to see if I can read in the actual name of the animation file and connect that in there so we actually have more relevant information. How many? Oh, right now we have three animations, and I'm going to stick to that. So you don't need to worry about that. And let's see if I could either convert the animations to code or reorganize the prefab so that the whole user interface works for everything. Nothing's broken. I spawn the objects a little bit. So if I go over here, notice as I get, let me switch to just a cube. Notice as I get close, I'm kind of covering the clock. I need a better way to figure out where I should stop spawning. More than likely, I'll probably just end up spawning behind. I'll probably re-move stuff around depth, distance-wise so that I'm not spawning on top of my interface. And yeah, my script is really one big class, and I really got to clean that up. So we have some work to do for Sprint 4. And so it's really just like nothing new. We just cleaning, fixing, reorganizing. And this is a good practice for yourself. You know, when you walk away from a project, you want to put it in a state that somebody else can pick it up or you can. It's just kind of like house cleaning. And then we have our final exam. I need to update this. It's not in finals week. We've moved it to that last week. So what I'll do for Sprint 4, we have like 3 weeks. I'll spend most of the, maybe two-thirds of the class on like actual Sprint 4, refactoring code. And since it's like code all the time, I'll start to do like preps for the final exam. Since the final exam is mostly just about code and interaction design. So I'll do like two-thirds Sprint 4, one-third final exam review. So as we move through the weeks, the 3 weeks, you'll drop your Sprint 4, which is like nothing new. We're just cleaning up a lot of stuff, and you're ready for the final exam. All right, so let me review Sprint 3. So So if I drag in, so if you remember, we have a hierarchy. This is what is currently existing in this scene, this build. Down here in projects, I'm going to shrink up animation. We have our prefabs here. So if I drag over cube animation down here in the animator, we can see that we have our three animations. We do have other states, but we're not connecting them. And our transitions, our ability to transition between animations. So I have my three all connected up. I go over to animation, click on the cube. We see that this one animation plays. The other animation plays. The third animation plays. So all three of my animations for this prefab work, and they're all connected together. And remember that we have a transition. Every state needs to transition to another one. That transition is based on this parameter, which is almost like a public variable that we can change per code call. And when we change it, the animator is aware of to do their checks and see if these transitions should happen. So for three different animations, we have six transitions to make sure that we can get every direction that we need to between them. So I'm going to bring in multi-cube because we went through the cube animation, animated cube and how to create those animations. Here's some new animations here I'd like to go over. So cube movement, yeah, we went covered this. I'm going to shift into an isometric mode, like a flat on mode, because I'm going to animate in the position in these next few ones. And it's useful to remove distortion to see what's happening. So this one is just bouncing the scale up and down. I go to curves, press the F key, just moving each of the three parts, each of the three cubes have a separate scale animation. So let's see, what's our second animation here? Cube rotation. So I'm going to go back to Dope Sheet, click play. So here we have just the two cubes cycling around the main cube. And as we see here, we're only animating cube left and cube right. So if I seek to recreate this animation, I'll go up into animations. And I'll call it multi-cube, the name of the object, and we'll call it rotation 02. And in here, we're only animating cube left, and we're animating cube right, and of the two, we're just animating its position. So when I drop those down, we have a key at the beginning, key at the end. So let's just focus on cube left first. So at some point, he starts far left. At some point, he centers up and he just moves up. So since his left point was negative 1.2, I'm just going to say his utmost point on Y is 1.2. It's the same distance off from the center. And at some point, he goes to farthest right. Our X 1.2 and Y is 0. And at some point, he goes back to center, but at the lowest point on Y. So if I click play, he's going to do something like this. Now you notice there's that little pop in his step. If I press the F key, remember that we should have some nice rounding at the top and the bottom, but the center, if I zoom out, maybe just do one curve at a time, the X curve, looks good. Notice like there's a little, notice how we're going from a min to a max to a min. And I didn't actually really need to define these midway points. And so if I delete them, that animation curve is still there. I just removed some information. And if I bring them back, you see how they weren't perfectly aligned with what the curve should be. I manually placed them. And so I kind of have this little, just a little hiccup. So just, I don't think you would really notice it that strongly, but just notice that I'm really defining the min and the max, and I didn't need to define those minimum, those medium points. So I could just delete them, and I zoom out to see how this animation will play into infinity loops. We have our nice up and down. All right, so there was a little work I had to do on the x. But the y, if I zoom out, we really have this issue where it kind of plateaus in the middle. And the reason for that is that our start and our end points are really at the middle. They're not a min or a max. So they really shouldn't have that kind of ease out, that easing, that flattening of the situation. So if I ease them out, or if I drag their tangents down and line them up with the way that the curve is naturally going, if I zoom out, notice how, I'll just undo it. So notice there was a bump, but as I take the two and soften them out, they don't exist, or that bump doesn't exist. We have our nice smooth up and down. And yes, I can say that, hey, look, there is another key right in the center that's not at like the end of our timelines, and it doesn't necessarily have to be there. And in fact, if I zoom out, because I'm manually placing it, my eyes, I'm not doing it mathematically, I'm just lining up visually, there is like a little bit of a skew, right, or a little bump. I can delete that too. So I'm kind of just cleaning up. And then here I have my Y, nice up and down. So if I click play, he's got that nice arcing motion. There's no pops or stops or weird jerking motion. So I just went through cleaning up the X and the Y, which happen to have a slightly little different situation or issues. But each were able to be resolved rather quickly to get a smooth animation. And really I do with, well, the Y anyway, the end points, the stop and it's stopping and starting and stopping in the Y perspective at the midway, not the min and max, where the X was easier to deal with, where it starts at the min, goes to the max, ends at the min. I didn't have to adjust the end points, but it did have these midway points that I ended up cleaning. So if I go back to the dope sheet, a few of these little key points were deleted. I did that in the curve area. But now I have like enough information, just enough information cleaned up to make a clean animation, and I removed stuff that was not working well. So since we did the left, the right is a similar situation. Oh, before I move off from the left, the only thing I have left to look at is, did I place my keys down? So at time 0, with the cube left is on the left, and at time 1, we're back on the left, and we have transition points up, right, and down. So if you notice, as I went through, I actually almost marked them off like perfectly, except this one is off time-wise a little bit. So at the 15, so remember there's 60 frames in a second. So 15 frames in means we're a quarter of a second in. 30 frames in, we're halfway in. So I actually happened to drop, say if they were off a little bit, notice the gaps here are not even. So I'd kind of have to move these to try and find where their gaps would be evened out. And so I did kind of drop this one correctly, this one, but if you notice, this last point where it's at Y down, it was kind of too far off. This means it would too much time here and too little time here. So if I made it really extreme and clicked play, notice how it kind of has a standard or a normal velocity going around, and it kind of speeds up really quickly at the end. So here, if I made it even more extreme, you see that it's offset. It's just not moving well. So we have to make sure that just our timing as well. So every 15 frames, it moves a quarter of a movement around. Since every 15 frames is a quarter of a second, the animation is a second, we have a nice steady speed throughout the whole animation. So now that I've done left, I can look at right, and we can do a similar situation. Right starts on the right. We happen to be at 1.4. I didn't place these perfect, so maybe I'll say, okay, I'm doing this convention of 1.2. I'll just update it here and at the I had the wrong key clicked. I gotta click here, say no, this should be 1.2. Click on the end, click on this key, highlight it, blue, 1.2. So now left and right are at the same position, but on separate sides. So anyway, the right, now that I figured out my timing, my spacing, now I know that I should be at part 15. He should be centered up. And if left is up, then right should be down. And now he's going to be at negative 1.2. He's going to be on the left, while the other one is on the right. And now he should be at x equals 0, which is, and y should be 1.2. If I click play, now they both look good. Right has that little hiccup thing going on. So I just have to go into curves, go into right. I'm only going to look at one curve at a time. Go off, press the F key. So we go from the X happens to be good. Looks like max to min to max. I do have a little hiccup or a little, I don't need that key there. And it smooths, I get rid of it, smooths out my line. Now why we have a few issues. One, we have that key sitting there where I don't need that. I can have a smoother line there in my endpoints. Happen to be a medial point, not a min or max, so I should really move their tangents. So if I zoom out now, we have a nice, if I undo it, notice there was a little kink hiccup. Just clean that up, click play, and I've got my animation nice and cleaned up. All right. So notice that it is a different state. So if I wanted to or needed to, I would have to reconnect it in here. In the other class, I went through and just redid all the cylinder stuff. So I think I'll save that for later. But let's just say maybe, yeah, I'll just show it. I'll just delete these and say, no, I want to connect up with this rotation. Now I have to kind of delete that. Make a transition from that direction that way. And then I have to transition to that state. So if I click on these, I made four transitions. They all have to be cleaned up now because I deleted them and redid them. So remember, our transitions are not time-based. So I'm going to click off has an exit time. And if they're not time-based, they actually need a condition. They need some check, some reason to transition. So with that, we have a parameter. And in this case, remember, it's like a public variable that we can check or update with code. In this case, it's going to be an integer, and we're just calling it lowercase state. All of our animators, all the prefabs need to have this because I've hard-coded that in my script. I've said we're changing something called lowercase state, and we're changing it to this integer. So if I go through here, I have to add conditions. So state equals, we're going from state 0 to state 1, or animation 0 to animation 1. So state would be equal to 1. Here we're going state 1 to 0. So state should equal 0. Here we're going from state 1 to state 2. So state equals 2. And here we're going from state 2 to state 1, so state should equal 1. So I've rebuilt my animator. I've kind of swapped out a new state, and I had to do new transitions. But at the end of the day, you need three prefabs that have an animator that has three animation states, all of them connected up. And they need this parameter, this state out here, because that's what we're grabbing. All this is coming back to this dropdown over here. That if I open it up, animation drop down, we have three animations, scale, rotation, position. It creates an enumeration from 0, 1 to 2, and that's why I'm using that 0, 1 to 2 to transition my animations. So the third animation that I'm using, let me zoom in here, multi-cube random. If I click play, it's doing this. So if I go back to Dope Sheet, what am I doing here? So if I just open up the center position, the center moves to the left, it moves to the right, and let me actually just create this. Actually, in this class, it was useful to create this. So let me do it again. Multi-cube random O2. So, add property. Actually, I'm going to show you a different way of doing it this time. So, you saw how I was able to manually click add property. What if I want to use these visual gizmos up here, these to move, rotate, and scale, and I don't want to have to go through and manually click add property. So I just created an animation. I'm going to click this record button. Notice how my timeline is red. Now I click on one part of my prefab I want to animate, and I use the move, rotate, scale. In this case, I'm going to move it. And I'm saying, okay, the animation at some, I'm just going to move forward a little bit. I don't know where exactly my animation at. I'm going to finalize this key location, but I'm going to move it to the left. And it's going to sit on top of that cube, the small cube. Now, when I did that, notice it placed some keys down for me. It added properties. So it's like clicking add property, going to cube center, go to transform, and adding the position. And then it actually placed the key down because I moved in the timeline, and then I moved the object or scaled or rotated. It added the key for me. So if I click play, it now actually has this animation. So I do have to go back and add this final position to it. So if I notice how it's just going from frame 0 to like frame 18, 17, whatever it is. I'm going to scrub back out to frame 1 and wrap them up, you know, move them back to position 0. So now he moves to the left, and at some point I'm going to want to move him to the right, and he's going to hit this cube. So if I click play, he moves left, then he moves right, and then he settles back into the center. So notice that he's moving to the left, so a half distance, then he moves like a full distance. So he's moving from center to left, and then from left to right, like the full length of this prefab, and then he's moving back to center. So the amount of distance he's covering, is this is like a half a unit, this is like a full unit, this is like a half unit. So based on the amount of distance he's covering, I'm saying, okay, these keys need to move out somewhere like that. Because this time, if he's only moving half the amount of distance, he should only move that over half the amount of time. If he's moving a bigger distance here, say twice as long as this distance, then he should move it over twice the amount of time to keep the same speed, if that's what you're trying to do. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to judge out, okay, I've got a second of animation. I know that this is the biggest distance he's moving from left to right, and then this is kind of like a half distance and is a half distance. So that's why I moved my keys out to try and figure out where they should be placed along this 1 second long animation. Once I do that, I'm just going to check the curves. I don't know if I'm getting a hiccup or not. I'm just going to zoom out. And it looks like I'm having a similar situation where the curves look good. They're spaced out well. But it looks like if I zoom out, I'm getting that little hiccup again. So if I move these tangents on the beginning and the end point and click play, there, that's a much smoother, I'm not getting that kind of pop, that disruption in his motion. All right, so I'm just looking at one aspect at a time, moving down a chain, is it timed out well? Pressing the F key to frame up. Where is he moving to? Over how much time should this object move? And then I click play to loop it and see if there's anything more I need to clean. Usually you have to go into the curves, press the F key one by one, look at them, see if there's keys you have to either delete, move, or move the tangent so that they kind of move cleanly. So I'm actually really happy with this. He's the center actor, the largest one. So I did him first. I timed out everything. Now let's move to the secondary actors, or the smaller cubes. So again, since I have this record button down, everything's red. All I got to do is move to the, I'm going to move to cube left, because that's the one that gets interacted with first. And I just have to move it to the side. And my keys get placed then, because the record button's on. Again, if you want to, you can click add property. You can place your keys down manually if you choose to. So what happens? This large cube comes over, hits the small cube, moves back. All right, so one thing you can notice, okay, they move well together. There's no overlap. So if I move cube left here, see he kind of speeds away. Actually, the placement was well here. If I move it past there, they kind of overlap each other. That doesn't work well. I'm going to move it back. So that's why I place this key at right with the left with the center cube. You don't have to spend time being very exact. Notice how I'm kind of zoomed in to this object closer than the user would see it. Notice how I'm in isometric view, looking at dead on. I'm really trying to be all perfect with it. I don't want to spend a lot of time with it because I'm purposely zoomed in a little bit more than the user, so that as long as it looks pretty good to me, you have to think about the user's perspective experience. He's going to be painting multiple of these objects on the screen at once. They're all going to be moving, and his camera view is zoomed out a little bit from what I'm seeing. So it's going to look even more better from his perspective. So I'm just making sure it looks as good as I can for the user and moving on. Doesn't matter if there's a little overlap. If they're not perfectly in sync, they look good enough for me. They'll look good enough for the user. So notice that, let's see, what else can we do with the left? We notice that he stays there. So he needs to go back. I can just take his original key, copy it, Control C, and say, all right, it looks like maybe somewhere around here. If I'm not sure where to place it, let me just paste it all the way at the end. And looks like he has this really slow kind of spring back to his original location. So maybe you want that, maybe you don't. I don't know. You're the designer of your own animations. I'm going to leave this alone. And I'm going to say it's good enough to move on to the next part, which is I have to work with the right side. So again, I'm in this record mode, so all I got to do is click on cube right and then say, let's see, the center cube's coming. And it looks like around this mark where the center cube goes its max distance, the right cube should as well. Now when I click play, notice his start position is all the way at time zero, and he starts moving right away, and he gets to his max at frame 45 and then stays there. So the first thing we have to look at is, he shouldn't move right away. If I look here, it looks like the left cube starts moving about each of these major lines are 5 frames. So I can say, okay, cube left starts moving about 15 frames, because I can mark these out quickly, before he hits his max. So, all right, maybe cube right should do the same thing. So I'm just going to drag his key over. 15 frames before he hits his max. Let's see how that looks. I think that looks pretty good. The only issue is he has this pop, so it's disturbing me. I can't really tell if everything is good because this pop pulls my attention so strongly. So I'm going to take this. I still have this key clicked on. It's blue. I'm going to copy it. It's just some data. Position data. I'm going to go to time 1, the end of my animation, and just paste it, Control V, And now he goes by this right cube, returns back to his original position. So now we have this center cube kind of bouncing back and forth, knocking the left and right cube. But notice that the left cube kind of has at least this kind of graceful return back to its original position, while the right cube kind of is this quick instant pop. So one way or the other, we have to fix that. Either, okay, what if we really like this really slow return on the left cube? Well, then kind of I have to open up my timeline to give more time for the right cube to come back. But then I have more time I have to consider, and I have to consider, oh, what should the center cube be doing, the left cube? That's kind of a headache. I don't really feel like doing that. If I need to, I will. But let me look at the other thing I could do. Maybe the right cube is good and left cube is too slow. So if the left cube returns back to its position, what can I see with the right cube? Over 15 frames, he moves from start, from his original position to his max position. 15 frames, he returns back to his original. Why don't I manipulate the left cube to do that as well and see what that looks like? So the left cube, over 15 frames, he gets pushed out of his original position, and 45 frames it takes him to return back. All I gotta do is take his ending position and move it up so that it's 15 frames to return back. Click play. That works for me. I'm happy. I don't want to do any more work. Yeah, I could look at the curves and try to finesse them and clean them just like I did in the other one. And if you want to, you can. But you know what? I think this looks pretty good. It's got this kind of springy effect to it. Let's go out of... Let's get out of record mode. This is important. If you stay in record mode and you touch something, it's going to record more information and you don't want that, and you get to go and figure it out where it is, delete it. Jump out of record mode when you're done. That's the one danger with this. It's really easy to start quickly building animations, but if you don't forget to get out of record mode, you're going to add more information as you're clicking on stuff and it just messes up your animation. So jump out of record mode. Next step. I'm going to get out of perspective mode, and I'm going to look at it as if I got to jump back to it. It was random. Or random too. I'm going to look at it in perspective as if it was a real paint stroke, and then review it. Does it feel correct? Should I edit anything? And I'm like, okay, this looks good. I'm good. I created my animation. So I can unclick play mode, pop out, and remember, here's the new state that I just created, the new animation. I can connect it in. That's kind of annoying. But, I mean, technically, I just recreated another animation just to show you. I don't need to rebuild the animator. But let's just say, okay, you made a new animation, and it's better than your old animation. Instead of having to reconnect all these transitions, you could just click the animation state you wish to replace. Notice here, it's referencing this multi-cube random animation. Here's random two. Just drag and drop it in. It overwrites the animation that that state is playing. I didn't have to kind of reconnect this new state. So that's another option for you too. But again, at the end of the day, all you want is one prefab. I can even click play here. I don't have to paint. I can have him just exist temporarily in this play mode just to test out his animator. I'm not sure why it's taking so long to run. Okay, here it is in the real play mode, you know, you wouldn't have it existing already, but you can see in the animator, we're running, looping on animation one. Then we can do a test. I can enter state one by pressing one. Notice we transition to another animation. and I pressed 2, or updated my variable to 2. Now I'm in my third animation. So I just tested this prefab, like basically like unit testing, just by itself. I tested it. Does it function right? So I know if I call its animator and I change the state integer to other integers, in this case we're just going from 0, 1, or 2, does the prefab work? Yes, it works. I'm good. So I can delete that. And I have multi-cylinders. So if I click play, here's what state 1 looks like, or state 0. Second animation, or state 1. And the third animation, or state 2. So for this one, I went and just created 3 animations and connected them up. As you create an animation, it's going to exist in your animator, but it will not have these transitions. So you're going to have to right-click, make transition, go to whatever state you want to transition to. Once you create the transition, you click on it, turn off has exit time, add a condition, whatever state number you're going into, that should be the integer. The only thing I wanted to show about the cylinder is, you saw this animation. I did this last week. I did this animation in just the last class. And this allowed me to kind of quickly talk about global and local orientation, which for this object, it was worth doing. So let me just do it in this class quickly. So in this animation, at the capsule center, all I'm doing is he's moving up and his scale is coming down. So we're just moving it in the Y. And all I'm doing is just scaling along the Y. So I had used the record feature in the last class to create this. And you know what? I'm just going to create it again. So I'm going to create a new animation. I'm going to go down, I'm calling it whatever the object is, multi-cylinders. And this one is rotation, called O2. All right, so we have a new animation. I'm going to go into record mode because I want to be nice and easy. I'm going to follow the same convention where it's a second long. It changes its status a half a second in and goes back. Just a very basic animation. All right. I'm going to select the center cube. All I'm doing with this one is moving it up, going into scale tool, scaling it non-uniformly. I'm just scaling it down in one direction. That's it. Moves up and scales down. Now I got to go to time 1, copy the original information, position and scaling, because I animated both, paste it in. Now it just does that. He moves up and he scales in, and he goes back to his original situation. Now if I grab capsule left, go back to my move tool, this is what you'll see. We're in global orientation. Your gizmo, they call it this visual handle that you can either change the transition, the rotation, or I should say position, rotation, or scaling information. It's aligned with the global axis, which is super useful most of the time. But sometimes, in this situation, this object is rotated 45 degrees along the Z, negative 45. That's why it's kind of slanted this way. You can get some really quick, interesting animations if we just grab the local coordinates. So notice my move handle. Let me rotate a little bit so you see that it's oriented with our compass up here. Are Z, X, and Y. If I switch here from global to local, notice the X is the same, but the Y and the X, I'm sorry, the Z is the same. The Y and the X have shifted 45 degrees. So it's aligning with this object. Let me get out of perspective. let me just look at it dead on and transition from local to global. So the cool thing about this is because this object is rotated, its local orientation is different than the global axis. Its own little axis, its own little coordinate system is different. And it allows me to just move it right along its own axis. So it happens to be rotated 45 degrees this way. I can just quickly move it along that direction. If I didn't have that globally, I'd have to kind of like move it up and move it over, or use this little square here and kind of try and find that exact position along its axis, its local axis. I don't need to do that. I can switch to local space, move to the time where I want it, and because it's aligned locally, I can just move it and scale it down. To scale it perfectly like that globally would be a pain in the ass. You gotta like scale it two directions and not the third. It's a mess. So that's the point of this local orientation. And then I'm gonna take the position and the scale. It makes more elaborate situations, animations, positioning a lot easier to deal with. So now I'm going to take capsule left and watch. I'm going to switch out a local and I'm going to try and do this global. So yeah, I would grab this, try to remember, line it up perfectly, and then scaling. It looks like scaling, you can't even do global. So I mean, it forces you into local anyway. But that's why this handle is aligned that way. So you're understanding what local is. So it actually, the scaling forces you to do it locally so you don't get into that messy situation. Oops. I copied the middle key into that last key. I mean, I need to copy the first key over into the last key. Now we have our animation. So I was actually able to position it relatively well, but I'm sure it's still not as perfect as if you just took the local and just moved it. Now you have to think about it. You just move it locally, it'll be perfectly aligned with it. So that's how you're able to create more of these kind of like geometric or these kind of symmetric animations quickly using this idea of a local orientation for scaling, rotation, and position. Yeah. If you haven't touched it,
yeah. It's rotated there, but it said it was 0, 0, 0.
So, right. So it's global. So if it's rotated off its parent, there's two. Let me grab. Let me make sure I'm out of the animation. There. So they're not blue. So, for example, capsule center was never rotated at 0, 0, 0. Capsule right was rotated negative 45, and left was 45. Now, so you're saying, so when you reference, this is why in code you could reference it like local rotation, local scale, or local position versus like just position, which is global. And a lot of the math gets simplified for us when we grab something locally as opposed to globally. So globally, this thing is rotated 45 degrees. And actually, a perfect situation here is why I built the daylight system like this. So if you remember, the directional light, I was already like rotated something. It was really awful for me mathematically to line up with the clock, meaning if it's midnight, I want the light pointing straight up. If it's like noon, I wanted pointing straight down. And I couldn't get that effect easily. So that's why this parent is actually rotated 90 degrees so that the directional, let me get out of isometric. And if I put a rotation here as 0, meaning this is what I want to be at midnight. So globally, this light source has this rotation on it, but locally it doesn't have it. So if I pull this directional light out, notice all of a sudden its rotation information has negative 90. If I pull it back into its parent, locally it's zero because the parent takes on that negative 90. So now I don't have to think about this offset. Everything is zeroed out very easy mathematically, locally. So I grab this directional light local rotation and I say, okay, if it's new, if it's midnight, it's up and it's like 15 degrees at, you know, 1 a.m. and 30 degrees at 2 a.m. and 60 degrees at 2 a.m. at 3 and so on until we get to noon, 180. And so this is how you can kind of think it gets zeroed out. If a parent has information on it and you're local, if you're a child, you can kind of think of your local space in a zeroed out situation, even though globally you're offset. So let me put the light back to something that was, yeah, that looks good. So anyway, this is how you can build animations. Connect three animations together in your animator, have a parameter that can be the condition for all these. Remember, for three animations, you need six transitions because it's a two-way street between them all. And I showed you that if you leave one prefab in, you click play, you can go into its animator, change its state to test if it fully functions. So if I delete multi-cylinder and click play, and let me turn off Time Destroy. That's why all three of these different prefabs share the same type of animator, because we followed a convention where the animator is always at the root. The animator will always have three animations. They're all governed by this state parameter, which is an integer, that can go from 0, 1, and 2. And because I follow that convention, I know that my code will always update it. So down here in the code, change animation state. So for future painted objects, we just change our animation state. And up here, this right here, we set its integer of its animator called state to whatever number that we're setting. And by default, it's 1, but remember we have these hotkeys, 1, 2, and 3, which can update it, or we can update it through our user interface here. And it's all it's doing is passing 0, 1, 2 to our change animation state. And we're just changing this integer, which keeps track of which animation state we're in. And then we go into our pre-existing paint strokes in this for each loop. We look at all the children of this transform. This script lives on our click manager object. We purposely place all of our existing paint objects as children of it. And then we can go through and do a check. If each child has an animator, then we're going to go through and set the integer on that animator, that integer called state. We're going to set it to this new integer called animation state. That's how we control existing paint strokes and yet to be painted paint strokes with this animation state. So with that, if there's no questions, I'm going to leave this review of our different prefabs, creating animators, setting them up with parameters, creating three animations, creating all the transitions, and then setting the specific transitions conditions between, so it should check which state number they should move between. All right, so the rest of the class, I just have to go over code. So is there any questions? How to create these prefabs? Because you're supposed to create three prefabs, each with three animations. And here's mine. 1, 2, and 3. So now I just cover the rest of the code I've yet to cover for this sprint, and we're done with class. Yep.
That drop down is a scale position and stuff. But that's not elegant.
Well, the user doesn't know about these hotkeys. These are really for quick testing. You could state that in your app, you know, switch between animations. The way the user would use it is they would use the drop down.
No, I'm saying like the names.
Oh, right. So if you follow convention where the first of all your animations have something to do with scale, something to do with the second one would have something to do with rotation. Sure, that makes sense. What else could you name it? Like anim 1, anim 2, anim 3. That's why one of my refactoring quests for Sprint 4, if I could do it, is maybe I should be pulling in the animation name of whatever I currently have selected. So if it's multi-cube, whatever the second animation of multi-cube is, maybe pull in that as the name. But it gets kind of long, and technically if you have different paint strokes on the existing, they should all go to animation 2. Right, and they might all not have the same name. But so, right, you might want to name this something like animation type, and there's just 1, 2, and 3. Maybe what I'll do is I'll just name it 1, 2, and 3, and just right above it I'll say animation type. So let me just, that might be the easiest way to deal with it. So maybe I'll update my user interface with that. But some way, yeah, we do need to approach that. And that'll be part of my refactoring. Is there anything else? Just about non-code, building prefabs, building animators, building animations. And they don't have to be perfect. This isn't, a style class. I just don't do anything. Like, if it's really hurts the eyes, and, you know, just make something at least, just do something simple. And you just see, I'm just like bouncing back and forth between variables of different transform types. Nothing crazy. But I have enough content. So that's kind of like the content side. So let me go over the script now. So last week in the update loop, we went over how to do these shortcut keys, 1, 2, and 3, how they map to changing animation states 0 to 1. And how we also can grab to that with our dropdown. This didn't change. This didn't change. This was right holding to delete. That doesn't change. This doesn't change. This I'm going to have to fix a little bit. This here, this is like when you stop painting on the left and right. Notice how as I paint, it kind of starts to cover over the clock here. I'm going to have to fix this in Sprint 4. Maybe paint the strokes behind, or maybe find a more dynamic way when to stop actually painting. This is just spawning our prefabs based on which shape we should be spawning. This is the same. This is just changing the shape of each prefab based on the previous location. This we went over, and we're going to do this kind of convention now in our scripts when we're updating the color information of existing objects. But here we're going through, we're checking each prefab at the root. Does it have a renderer? If so, a random color, random emission. Does it have children? If so, does the children have renderers? We have to go through. So we do this because I have something like this cube where there's nothing, there's no children, and it has a render right at the top. It's just a cube. Then we got some stuff like this, multi-cubes, where there's no rendering at the root, but we have objects underneath children that have renders. So I went through how to check does the root of our prefab have a render? If so, apply some color. Then we do a check, are there children? If so, we're going to have to loop through each one and check each child. Does it have a render? If so, we paint it on it. So I covered this last week. So this code should be good to go. Then I said, okay, we just spawned a prefab. We spawned a painted object. Does it have an animator? If so, we have to set its animation state. By default, this animation state is 0. Our script says it's 0. The animator starts at state 0. But either in the user interface, you can change the animation state number or pressing 1, 2, and 3. And that updates this integer that gets assigned to every future paint stroke. Now, the rest of these, I purposely commented them out last class. I'm going to talk about in this class. I'm just going to skip this part for right now, but I'll return back to it. This is all the same, assigning the transform when we spawn it to the script's game object. How much should we do time destroy and how much? And then recording our click position. And then we record the current mouse position to our UI. This is the same. These are new. I go over them later. So this change animation state, this I did cover last week. This, if we change the animation state, which is this drop down, it passes in an integer, 0, 1, or 2. We have three animation states. We just update our animation state integer for current and future painted objects. And then we tell the dropdown, we update our UI because we can also do quick keys, 1, 2, and 3, which are not connected to the user interface. So to keep everything in sync, we tell the dropdown which animation state we're in, just in case we're pressing 1, 2, and 3. Then we go through each of the transforms, each of the pre-existing painted strokes, and we look, do they exist under our click detector manager? And we go through them. Do they have animators? If so, we're going to set their states because something called this script, either the user interface dropdown or the user pressed 1, 2, and 3, we need to update our animation states of our pre-existing objects. I'm going to cover this in a bit, how to change the animation speed. This is worth covering now. So if you remember last week, I had to go through how to assign color information. Now that we have prefabs, it might have a render at the root, might have render in the children. I went through how to check at each level, is there a render? If so, let's assign some color information and some emission information to it. Then let's check its children and do the same thing. Since that's rather fresh in our mind, we can go through how to update, change red, change green, change blue, change emission strength, change opacity strength. The rest of this script is as is. We don't have to worry about these. These are our pre-existing functions that don't get modified this week. So, change red. So, I'll talk about this briefly, and then I'll talk about why I did it this way. So this should look familiar. If the user drags the slider, red, green, blue, red, green, blue, they're going to call either change red, change green, or change blue. Change red, we pass in a float called temp from 0 to 1 based on wherever the slider is. So first off, we're going to go through existing paint strokes and see which need to be updated. So first off, we start off for each transform child and transform. We're looking at the paint strokes underneath our click manager. Is there a render at the root of the paint stroke? If so, we need to do some changes. Then, while we're within the for each loop, we go into another for each loop. And we say, are there more another level of children underneath the current level of child? And then we're going to go through and update their paint, their render information, their color information. So let me just paint two different paint strokes and pause it. So here's some cubes. Here's some multi-cubes. I don't actually need to pause it because I turned off time delay. So underneath my click detector, this is the stuff that we're going to find in that first level of the for each loop. So we have some cube animated who has a renderer at the top, at the root. And then we have some multi-cubes which don't have a renderer at the root, but they have renderers on the children. So we run into a situation with, we don't know how many children currently exist, which are painted objects. That's okay, because the for each loop takes care of a lot of this for us. It's going to go through, create a for loop. It's going to set up how long that for loop, that length should be, all dynamically, based on how many children there are. And it's going to check all of their roots. Now, for a cube animated, it will have a renderer, and it will do something. For something like multi-cube, it does not have a renderer at the root. It will not do something. So if it does have a renderer, it's going to go grab the color information, the currently existing color information. It's going to put it into this variable called painted object color. Now, currently, we're not using this variable. It's used in our update loop when we're actually spawning a prefab, but the user's not clicking into world space right now. The user is actually interacting with the slider. So we can reuse this variable. It's kind of just sitting there empty. So we're going to store in the current prefab's color information, and then we're going to change the red information on it. So this temp, this float that just came in, is coming from us interacting with the slider. The slider can go from 0 to 1 because that's what we specified. And that information plugs into our R. So do we want to lower or raise our red information? It can only go between 0 and 1. And then we go back and we set the color information of that child to this new variable. The variable, the green and the blue and the alpha all stay the same. We're just changing the red. So the old way I was doing it, I'll just uncomment this out. And comment this might be a little bit more transparent what's happening. We pull in the color information of the child, we store it in this variable, then we update the variable. We basically give it a new color data structure. Remember, color is just a vector for floats. The floats represent red, green, blue, and alpha. So we're saying, okay, create a new color data variable structure. Give it this new red information, but keep the currently existing green, blue, and alpha, and then this new data structure, plug it or reference it with our variable, and then pass that along and update our child's data, child color data with that. Yeah. What's that? This one right here? So this one and this one are technically doing the same thing. They're updating the red information, but leaving the green, blue, and alpha alone. So if we take one paint stroke, just say this one, we pause it so all this animation's not happening. It has existing color information. And let me change this over to red, green, blue. And let me change it to red, green, blue from 0 to 1. Just this one child, as we iterate through, we're just focusing on one child right now, one prefab. Here's its red, green, blue, and alpha information. I wonder if I can update it. That'd be great if it would update live here. But we're basically, you can kind of see it here, we're changing red from 0 to 1. Whatever we're dragging on this slider over here, we want to take this color information, store it in a temporary variable, change that variable, and send it back and update the color information on that same child. We can't go to that child and change its color information directly, but we can assign it to a variable, update that variable, and pass it back. So here we are retrieving the current information. We change it somehow, and here we are passing it back. So these two lines do the same thing. It's just this one might be more, show you more information of what's happening. We're keeping green to be the same. We're keeping blue the same. We're keeping A to alpha be the same. We're just changing red, and that's based on whatever the slider is. So here's the current information, is this type of purplish color. Let's say the user takes the red slider and pulls it all the way down. It would turn into this type of blue in color. But for us to do that, we need to pass the new red information. But we can't just pass it the red information. We have to pass it a whole new color data structure. But we don't want to change blue, green, or alpha. This is able to actually just change the red information directly. This one, I'm actually creating another data structure saying, okay, keep red, green, or keep green, blue, and alpha, change red. But you want to make it look a little bit cleaner. Technically, I don't need to do that. I could take this temporary variable and just say, give me its float, change it to whatever the slider is. And it keeps blue, green, and alpha. And then I'm passing it back. So go find the color, go assign it to a temporary variable, change just the red part of it, send it back to the object. Once we do that, we have to go through each of its children. So I'm calling them grandchildren because technically the click detector is the parent. The prefabs are children, and if the prefabs have more game objects underneath them, they're grandchildren. So if there's any child in this transform, which are prefabs, we do this, and then we go into another loop. If there's any more children, if the prefabs have children, which I'm just calling grandchildren here, we're going to go through and check if they have renders. If so, we're going to grab their information, store it in a variable, update red, and then send it back to that same game object, which happens to be a child of a prefab, and the prefab is a child of the click manager. So if I look here, parent, child, grandchild. And I have to go through and sort through them all and see which ones I'm updating, which I'm not. So it's almost like I'm building a list of all existing paint strokes. Each node or each part of this list is a prefab, and each prefab may have a list underneath it, may have children game objects that we need to go through and update their colors as well. So if you get what's happening here, I do this over and over and over again to update my script. So I'm going through two for each loops. One, okay, here's the click manager. Is there any existing paint strokes underneath it? Put them all on the list. Let's go through them all and do something. We see if we have to update a renderer. Then for each node, each part of the list, we say, okay, we got to go into another list potentially and see if there's any children. If there's no children, forget about it. There's no secondary list. If there's children, we list them up and we go through them and change all their renders as well. Now in this structure, only prefabs can have children. We're not going down into another level. But if I did, we would need to go down into great-grandchildren. But that's getting too crazy. We're just seeing if the prefabs have children. And we have to go through each one and update their color information. In this case, we're just updating the red information and we're keeping everything else the same. Then once we're done with all of that, we just keep track of, you know, our red float, our internal float that tells us where red currently is. We update that. And then we go back to the UI to update that text element. Instead of going from 0 to 1, we're just going from 0 to 100, and we're truncating off the decimal. That's how we get this number here updated. So I'm either washing out all the red or putting all the red up. But remember, it's currently assigned a random color information, and we're only washing down and back up to that original red information. That's why I can do this. This guy is actually fluctuating colors in his animation. Let me get rid of him because it's going to be too confusing to see right now. So if I just wash out the reds and bring them back. All right. The greens and the blues. All right, so change red. Change green is the same thing, but now we keep red, blue, and alpha, and we're changing green, and it's the root of the prefab and any children the prefab has. Blue, we're going in, we're keeping red, green, alpha, and we're just changing blue. And then we go through and record what our float should be at and what the user interface should be at. Now we have to deal with emission and opacity. And as you see, the structure for emission, very similar. We're going through our list of prefabs and looking to see if they have children and seeing which levels have renders so that we need to update them. If we need to update them, we grab the color information that currently exists, put it into a variable. Then we're going to create a new emission color. So if you remember the emission, if I just pause it and just grab one of these. That's weird. I have to take a look at the multi-cubes. But the emission color follows. So if I bring in, let me switch my paint stroke around. The convention I was following. Pause it, open up one of these. Here we go. So the emission color is just following the color information. So at some point, there's some random color assigned to it. The emission color, if I go up where we originally assign it, we get a random color information assigned to color. And then we take whatever the emission strength is and multiply it by the red, the green, the blue, the original color information, and put that in the emission. So basically the emission has that same hue as the main color. It's just ramped down a little bit. So emission, or a glow effect, can make it blow out if it's at 100%. So if I switch to multi-cube, let me turn off time destroy. So it looks like emission and without emission. So basically what's happening is, to update it, we take in the color information, because emission is based off the color information, and we pass in that into our color variable. And then we can create our emission color from that. So new color, we take in red from color, multiply it by this temp that's coming in from the slider, the glow slider, the emission slider. It goes from 0 to 1. 1 means it's full glow. It's almost like a light bulb. 0 means there's no glow to it, no emission. So we're multiplying red by this 0 to 1. So it'll always be a little bit less. It'll always be like fully whatever the red is, are down to zero. But it's always following the color. Same with green. G times temp, B times temp. Put that into our emission color and plug that in. Child render material set color. What are we setting? The emission color. And we're passing in that emission variable into it. Then we have to go through the children, which we're calling grandchildren because everything is a child now because they exist underneath the click manager. And they're doing the same thing. If this exists, this child of the prefab, and it has a renderer, we're grabbing its color information, we're storing it, and we're creating a new emission color based off of that information, just multiplying it by this temp, the slider, from 0 to 1, so that the user can now impact the emission. And then we're updating. We're sending that emission color back to the material and moving on off of that child. And then we're updating. We're taking that temp and passing it into our emission strength, our float of the script that is managing or keeping track of where the current emission strength is so that when we're painting, the new painted objects get that emission strength. And then opacity is the same thing, but opacity is simpler to deal with. It's basically just updating the A, the alpha. So the slider goes from 0 to 1. 1, fully opaque. 0, meaning invisible. So if I paint it, fully opaque to not. So all we're doing again is we're going through existing objects. If there's a render, grab its color information, put in a variable, change the A, the alpha, the fourth float in it, to whatever the slider is passing in, send that back to the child, update its color. And then we go through all of its children if they exist and update their alpha as well. The rest of these I don't care about. So that was covering all of the color updates. For the fact that now we have prefabs where the renderer might be at the root of the prefab or it might be at a child level. So I've got like 20 minutes left and I just have to cover animation speed and randomizing animations. What's that? Oh, is it really? Did I go over with this class? All right. So you're free to go. I went long in this class, so I'm going to go into changing animation. You can just watch this on the video. But I do have to cover how I'm doing the randomization and how I'm doing the animation speed. So that let me just click play real quick, and I'll show you that when I paint something, here's the speed. So let me turn off time speed. So here it's like the animation's frozen, it's paused. Here it's speed of 100%. Here it's a speed of 200%. Then I can randomize the speed. So all the animations are the same on all these objects, but they're all being played at different speeds. Or I can randomize the type of animation that's being played. So all these prefabs have up 3 random animations being played on them. And you can randomize speed and type at the same time. So free to go. And I'm just going to keep talking. Yeah.
Can you go back to like line 130? It was like really randomized in color.
For the first time?
Yeah. Can you like show us what the end of those lines do? Because they get cut off.
Oh. Yep. So basically this is the alpha information. So R, G, B. And so the lines that are getting, it's the emission. So the emission is based off the color. So we're randomizing the color. And the color, the alpha, is being controlled by this opacity strength, which the user can manipulate in the user interface. We're setting that color information. And then we have to create the emission color. So the emission color is based off the color information, but just multiplied by some factor, some decimal, which will reduce it. So RGB, based off the randomized color, multiplied by some value between 0 and 1. And then we're setting that emission. And then the same for any children. All right, so change animation speed. I'm continuing the previous class. So you can sit in, and we'll start up in 10 minutes. So change animation speed. So toggle slider, here we go. So there's two parts to this. We have this animation speed, which is going from 0 to 2. We can set its value, and it's calling this script. Changing this method, change animation speed. So all change animation speed is doing is it's passing in this float. It's looking at existing painted objects. I'm just wrapping up an existing lecture. So it's looking at which prefabs already exist, and if they exist, do they have an animator? If they have an animator, we're just changing the animation speed. So get the child, get game object, get component animator dot speed. So this is just a publicly accessible float. We're just passing in the temp. So float temp, it's coming from this slider, which goes from 0 to 2. And it's adjusting the overall speed of our animator. 0 means it's paused, 1 means normal, 2 means double speed. Anything less than 1 is like slow motion. Then we're updating our existing float, our existing animation speed that our script takes care of. And we have to go back to our user interface and update the number on it. So if you see here, it's going from 0.0 to 2.0. This is a float, so it has a long, it's like, right now it's like 0.654321, blah, 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 blah. To the user, I don't think they need to know that. I think they only need to know a tenth of a second. That's all they really care about. And if you remember in the existing parts of the UI, I took a button, I just removed its functionality, so it's just a flat image to help us to read this information. And underneath it is a text element. So by default, the text is 1.0 sec because the slider starts there. And I can update it. So first, I just need a public reference. So public text anim amount. And then I can update that. So I can grab the text element of it. And what am I setting it to? The animation speed, which is our float managing the speed. We're using toString, and it's only having one decimal, so an int dot the tenth place, and adding the sec, this string to it. So that's how I'm sending that. If I go to click detector and anim amount, I actually found this part of the user interface and connected it in, and that's why I'm allowed to update this text element, which we've done before, from 0.0 to 2.0. So I'm sending that information back to the user interface. So I'm just finishing up the lecture from the previous one since I'm recording it. And then last, I just have to cover how I randomized our, if I turn on the speed here, they're all moving at different speeds. I press the one key. It's all the same animations, different speeds. And how do I randomize the different type animations that are being played? So we have these two toggles. So let's look at toggle animation speed. It's a toggle. It defaults to false, and it's just calling this method change animation speed random whenever we change it. And it just has a button with a wrong button with a text on it. A text doesn't get updated. It just says speed. So it's calling this method change animation speed random, passing in a bool, and we're just setting is anim speed random, which is just a bool I created, private bool. It's not default to anything, so it defaults to false. And I'm only using it here. So here's where we're instantiating our current painted object, and we're changing the scale of it, we're changing the color of it. And I went over one line last class, right here. All right, I'm sorry, here. Set integer. And whatever animation state that the prefab should be in, we're passing in that integer. Well, now I'm passing in not only the speed that should be adjusted, but we're checking if it should be randomized or not. So if this is false, we skip this, and whenever we instantiate a new painted prefab, we're setting its animator speed to animation speed, which by default is 1, but the user can adjust with the user interface. And we update here so that future paint strokes also get updated with animation speed. But now we have a randomization factor. So if we are want to randomize, we first call random range from 0 to 1 and set our animation speed to that. Technically it should be 0 to 2 because the user can go to 2, but we're basically going from should the animation pause to the animation be at full speed, and then we're setting our speed to that. So that's how this randomization toggle works. And if we randomize the type, all that one is doing is we have is anim type random, and we're setting that. By default, this is false, and we're just setting our animator state to whatever we have it set at default, which is 0, or if the user selects a different dropdown, we update that state. Now we can do a check. If the animation type is random, we can randomize the animation state. So we call random range, which accepts floats. We have a min and a max. We go from 0 to 2.99. We're going to get a random float, and then we're going to cast it to an int because our animation state receives integers. And so the way this works is we have from 0, 0 to 0.9999. So we have like a full chance of picking a float of in the 0 range, and we're going to, when it gets cast to an int, any of those 0 floats turn to just 0. So 0.1 turns to 0, 0.9 turns to 0. That's our, if we do receive any of the, between that range, that 0 becomes an integer and it gets cast to our animation state. If we get anything from like 1.0001 to 1.999, that's going to be cast to a 1. That'll be sent to our animation state. And if we get anything from 2.000 to 2.999, it'll be cast to a 2. So that's why we go to there. So if you get like, we don't go up to 3, or like 3.99, because now we're including that we might get an integer of 3. And our animation state, the way we have it set up, is just 0, 1, 2. So if we did like a 2.5, just so you know that we have like a full chance of getting a 0, a full chance of getting a 1, and like a half chance of getting a 2. Because we're only going to be randomly spawning from 2.0 to 2.5, not like the full ranges of 2s. So that's why I just do like 2.99 or 2.9f. Like, does a 2 will get just as much of a chance to get spawned as 0 or 1. So if we did like 2.99, there might be like a one out of a 100th percentage chance you know, that two isn't as equally as random or as called back as 0 or 1. But the user would never see that. If you did something like 2.5, where 2 is only going to be randomly called half as many times as 0 or 1, the user might notice that. So here I'm going to say 2.99. We have a full chance of getting a 2, a 1, or a 0, and we can randomize our animation state and then set that state. So that wraps up that lecture.